Lines 1 to 9. One of Ulysses' mariners, after a weary journey on the seas, points to a land that comes into his sight, and addressing his companions, tells them that soon the high wave will take their boat to that land. The poet then describes the land of the lotus eaters, and having reached there, Ulysses' companions find that it is a pleasant land and that the air there is moving slowly, which looks like the breathing of a tired man who has fallen asleep and, while dreaming in sleep, breathes very slowly. The moon there was standing full in the sky, and there was also a thin stream which fell from a rock and then stood there for a while before moving downward further. Lines 10 to 18. Ulysses and his companions find that it was a land of many streams, some of which looked like thin veil of gauze slowly moving like a lazy sheet of foam. They also saw that the mountain peaks were covered with old snow on which the light of the sun was falling. There were pine trees on which the drops of water were there, and the heads of those trees were upward in the sky. Lines 19 to 27. It was the land where the lotus eaters lived. The sun at that time was going to set in the west, but it was taking some time to do so. The valley was in the middle of that land between the mountains, the margins of which were yellow because of the light of the setting sun falling on them, and around those valleys were palm trees. There were meadows covered with soft galingale grass, but the land was always the same with no changes being visible. Lines 28 to 36. The residents of the lotus land, when they came near the mariners, were holding branches of the lotus trees, and on those branches there were lotus flowers and fruits. As they came there, they gave those branches to each of the mariners. The mariners, as soon as they tasted the fruit, became completely changed men. Though the waves of the sea were moving towards them, yet to them it seemed that they were moving away from them to unknown and faraway shores, and when those mariners spoke to one another, their voices too had changed. Their voices became very thin as a result of eating lotus fruits, and it seemed as if they were speaking from their graves, and it also appeared as if those mariners were sleeping, although in reality they were awake and not sleeping. Lines 37 to 45. Having eaten the lotus fruit, the mariners lay down upon the sand of the sea of the lotus land, and as it was the evening time, the poet calls it the time between the sun and the moon. Under the effect of the lotus fruit, though they began to think of their native land and of their wives and children, yet now they had no will left in them to go and meet them. In the meantime, one of them cried aloud that they would return no more to their land and people, and the same sentiment was echoed by his other companions. Such was the effect of the lotus fruit on them. Lines 46 to 56. Then all the mariners began to sing together in one voice. They sang about the music of the lotus land, and the music on their ears fell more softly than the lotus petals falling on the grass, and equally tenderly fell the night dews on the motionless waters of the lake between the dark granite walls of the mountain. It is the effect of the music of that land that calls for the comforting sleep from the happy skies. There were the ivy creepers which were growing among the cool mosses, and the dews were falling from the long-leaved flowers growing in the waters of those streams, and there was also the smell of the poppy plant growing among the ledges made in the rocks. Lines 57 to 69. The mariners, comparing their lives with the objects of nature, complained that in nature all things have rest, while man alone is destined to labor and has no rest. Man is said to be the best creation of nature, yet he is always moving and working, and unlike the birds, cannot fold his wings for rest. He is never allowed to rest from labor, nor allowed to enjoy the balmy sleep, nor allowed to listen to his inner voice that says that in life there is peace but no joy. All in all, man is never allowed to rest from toil. Lines 72 to 83. According to the mariners, in nature all plants naturally grow into their leaves and buds, which become flowers and fruits without any labor on their part. Nature does all the work for them. The wind, the sun, the moon, and dews at night make the fruit juicy, and apples are filled with juice during the autumn season. All things in nature have their allotted days. They ripen, fall, and die, and for all this they are least required to labor. Lines 84 to 98. The mariners in the lotus land are of the view that there is no pleasure or joy in life, and there is all the pleasure in having rest and not working at all, either in the form of death or of dreamful rest. It is no use struggling in life because all things are heading towards their death. Death is the ultimate goal of life, and sleep and rest are different forms of death. So, death or rest is preferable to life and living. Lines 99 to 114. The mariners now imagine that life should be full of dreams, which means it is half awakened and half asleep. This kind of life they can have on the lotus land only while eating the lotus and growing old and doing nothing but watching the waves of the sea and see them striking against each other into fine, creamy sprays. While on the lotus land, they can afford to be influenced totally by the sad memories of the people of their earlier days, and in imagination they can think about them who in bodies are now buried and covered by grass, and all that remains of them now is only two handfuls of dust stored in an urn of brass. Lines 115 to 133. The mariners now say that the memory of their wives and their warm embraces and tears are comforting to them in thought, but now all must have changed in Ithaca. If they return home, they may not find a warm welcome because it is long time since they departed from their homes and wives, and their figures have now much changed, and in their island they may be taken to be ghosts by their people. It is equally possible that suitors from the nearby islands have usurped all that once belonged to them. It is equally possible that there has been disorder in their kingdom in their absence, and now they may not be in a position to restore order there. The fact must also be considered that because of the long war and looking at pole star for long hours for the guidance of their boat, their eyesight has become very dull. For all these reasons, they give up the idea of their home return. Lines 134 to 135. The mariners sing to themselves that it is extremely pleasant to lie down here on the flowers of amaranth and moly under the dark and holy sky, and they with half-shut eyes can look at the emerald-colored waters falling from the purple hills that bring ringing sound from the caves, which are covered with vine creepers, and it is also really very pleasant to see and hear from this distance the waves of the sea, which are shining because of the bright sun, while they themselves are resting under the shadow of the tall pine trees. Lines 146 to 175. The mariners now sing that the lotus are seen blooming on the island on every hilltop and creek of the hill, and low and soft wind is blowing all the time, and there are spicy plants on the hill slopes. Remembering their past sea life, they say that they had enough toil, movement, and adventure. They have been rolled over in their boat from one side to the other as the boat was rolled by the waves of the sea while the sea monster spouted more water into the sea. They suggest that they must take an oath never to return from that place, but to permanently live there. They say that on this island they will live like Greek gods and will not listen to the cries and miseries of mankind who have to suffer famine, plague, earthquake, troublesome sea and burning sand. Like the gods, they will drink nectar instead of water and will be indifferent to the pains and worries of human beings. Like gods again, they will have pleasure in listening to the cries and moans of the people on earth. They will laugh at the hard labor which the human beings have to undertake for the ordinary necessities of food and drink, and they will also like to see human beings dying and being killed. They will be happy to see human beings after their death going to hell and suffering their worst. For all these reasons, they desire not to return to their homes and not to lose the blissful life they have on the Lotus Island.